Globally, we now consume 4 billion tons of oil every year. Oil spills from shipping accidents and offshore blowouts are rare, but when they happen, the impact on the environment, on livelihoods, and on the local economy can be severe. In this series, we'll be asking the key questions. What issues do we need to consider? What expertise and techniques are available? And how do we deliver a well-planned and executed response to minimize impact? In this programme, we'll be looking at how we can most effectively manage oily waste from the moment it's collected until its final treatment or disposal. Waste management is often a major operation after a large spill, and it can be, in some cases, the most challenging aspect of the response. Even a minor spill can create so much waste that it quickly becomes a bottleneck, potentially bringing the response to a standstill. So what can be done to prevent scenes like this, when the 20,000 tonnes of oil that spilled from the Erika in 1999 resulted in 250,000 tonnes of waste? And given that most waste from a spill will end up being incinerated or disposed of in landfill, what can we do to alleviate this problem? It's all about having a waste management plan. And to find out more, I'm meeting up with Kelly Reynolds from ITOPF. Kelly, even before there's a spill, how important is the planning?
Well, as with all aspects of oil spill response, planning is crucial, and it's certainly no different for handling oily waste during a spill. Waste management is something that really needs to be considered in the contingency planning stage to make sure that it's integrated as part of the overall response strategy.
Right, so you've got to have a plan in place. When a spill does occur, then what?
Well, when you've actually had a spill, one of the first things that you want to do is to try and estimate the amount of oily waste that's likely to be generated by the incident. Because once you've got that estimate, you can then start to think about how you might handle those volumes of material.
That sounds very difficult. I wouldn't even have thought that's possible. How do you know how much oil is going to spill and how much waste you'll be dealing with?
Yeah, I mean, it does seem like quite a daunting task to do that. But there are a couple of factors that you can consider to try and help make that estimate. For example, what is the type of oil that's being spilled? Is it a persistent oil that you're dealing with? But importantly, what is your overall response strategy? You know, you're using dispersants, which generally produces less oily waste as a response strategy compared to containment and recovery. And we know from experience that even a really well-managed response can still produce significant volumes of oily waste. You know, sometimes it can be up to 10 times the volume of oil originally spilled.
To limit this volume, a well-managed response needs to consider a variety of individual waste streams. Every different substance the oil touches will generate a new stream. There's liquid oil, emulsified oil, oily beach material, oiled organic material, contaminated fishing gear, and oiled protective equipment. An effective response will make separate provisions for each of these streams in turn. There's a well-established framework for classifying and prioritising waste management solutions. The overall approach is to reduce, reuse, and recycle as much as possible before considering disposal. So let's look at those one by one. Firstly, and most importantly, can you reduce how much oily waste is generated? Ideally, you should choose shoreline cleanup techniques that minimise the quantities of clean material and water you collect. And try to avoid making excessive use of consumables, especially sorbents, which can further complicate the disposal. Next, we should reuse cleanup resources such as oiled equipment and protective clothing wherever possible. And waste oil has calorific value, so sometimes it can be recycled as fuel for generating heat or as raw material for building projects.
And the final and least desirable option, when waste can't be dealt with in any other way, it has to be incinerated or disposed of in landfill sites.
I'm going to follow the journey of oily waste from sea to shore and from temporary storage to transportation for treatment and disposal. At every stage, there are key considerations to be made if the waste is to be managed effectively.
A black tide of oil from the wrecked tanker Amoco Cadiz washes up on the northwest French coast.
Here in Brittany, they've become all too familiar with major oil spills.
The tanker, carrying at least 24,000 tonnes of fuel, was ripped in two by gale force winds.
Whenever there's an incident, it's important to consider the type of oil that's been spilled, because this will affect the overall volume of waste.
You have different grades of oil, light products, crudes, and indeed heavy fuel oils, and they will behave differently. Some of them will evaporate and disperse, so minimising the amount of waste that needs to be collected or is generated, and others will actually emulsify, so bulking up the amount of contaminant that you need to recover and store by up to fivefold.
The longer oil is at sea, the more chance it has of bulking up and mixing with other materials, multiplying the overall volume of waste, and you need to account for this. If the response strategy involves recovering oil at sea, then to avoid interruptions, it's important to maximise storage space.
When you collect oil from the sea surface, you're always going to collect a certain amount of water, and really you need to try and reduce that as much as possible. So a good way of dealing with that is to actually decant some of the cleaner water off. That can be done through oily water separators, or it can just be done by simple gravity. Of course, it depends where you are in the world, because there is different legislation. And indeed, in some parts of the world, it is regarded as reintroducing a contaminant to the sea, and therefore you can't even do that.
Once the oil comes ashore, it can be mixed with many other materials, sand, pebbles, wood, plastics and seaweed, and it can be difficult to separate them out. It's likely to come ashore at the same places where debris collects naturally, so a coastal survey can identify these spots, and it may be possible to make collection and disposal easier by clearing away the debris before the oil arrives.
When oil comes ashore, it might hit the strand line, so there'll be debris that become oiled. The cleanup responders themselves will be wearing protective equipment that will become oiled. There might be fishing gear and mariculture nets and floats that become oiled as well. Everything that the oil touches potentially can be waste.
One way to minimise waste is to clean oily sand or pebbles in situ, rather than removing them with the oil. For instance, you can use seawater to flush out the oil, leave the cleaned material in place, and use skimmers or sorbent materials to collect the oil. This approach may be labour-intensive, but with less waste to be disposed of, the overall operation may be more efficient.
It's a matter of logistics. If you can segregate your different types of waste into various waste streams, they don't all need to be disposed of in the same way. So you'll have some waste streams that might be reused or recycled, and they don't all need to go to a final disposal as contaminated waste.
Segregation of waste streams became an issue during the Erika spill. 50,000 tonnes of emulsion reached the shore within a few days, and because it was relatively easy to collect, the response quickly ran out of storage sites. To find out more about the knock-on effect of this, I'm meeting with Franck Laruel from ITOPF.
Did they segregate the streams of waste?
Initially, yeah, the segregation was done on a number of sites. The problem was due to this lack of space, you know, and the whole different streams were mixed together at some point.
Wow, so they did segregate the waste, but then they ended up mixing it all together. What problems did that then cause later on?
It makes the treatment of the waste much more difficult, I mean, much longer and more expensive, because basically you have to re-separate the stuff.
Ah.
So what was done during the Erika was they basically washed 250,000 tons of oily waste with diesel oil and separated aggregate, sand, oil, water, because there was a lot of water, and all the rubbish, seaweeds and debris collected on the shoreline.
Goodness me. So what does that mean for the actual cleanup on the shoreline? Does it slow things down?
It actually did slow down the cleanup in some areas due to the fact that the temporary storage near shore and intermediate storage were full. So all the sites, the work sites feeding this storage could not, they had to stop and slow down gathering the emulsion.
This problem can be alleviated by being as selective as possible when gathering waste on site, even if that does mean going more slowly than some would like.
The Erika was in a very touristic area, so people want the places to be cleaned up very quickly because the image of the site, even though it was in winter. So there's pressure to go quickly, and the problem with going too quickly is that you may end up with a lot of beach material mixed with the oil.
The Erika case shows the importance of segregation and of having storage scaled to the demands of the spill. More storage sites were built, but once dismantled, they contributed another 60,000 tonnes to the final total of waste. It's important to keep a record of how much and what type of oily waste is collected. It's a measure of progress with the cleanup and would also be useful in preparing claims for compensation.
In these situations, it can be a battle against the clock, and you need to keep the cleanup going. Therefore, between collecting the waste and eventually disposing of it, it's important to have temporary storage solutions.
In shoreline cleanup, oily waste is normally stored temporarily at the back of the beach above the high watermark. This allows some time to decide on the most appropriate way to deal with it, but even this temporary measure needs to be carefully thought through.
Secondary contamination can be a real problem, particularly in shoreline cleanup, when you've got oil leaking from the temporary storage sites. It can be really frustrating to find that sites that were previously clean have become oiled just from poorly managed waste.
If bottlenecks in the response are to be avoided, the next stage, transportation of waste, needs to be carefully planned. It can involve some complicated logistics to make sure that there's a steady flow of waste between the cleanup sites, temporary storage, and the final destination.
When it comes to treatment or disposal of waste, there are a number of options, but which one to go for depends on several factors: the nature and consistency of the waste, the availability of suitable sites and facilities, the cost, and of course, national and local regulations.
Given that we always aim to reuse and recycle waste, the first and most obvious treatment option is to recover as much of the actual oil as possible for reuse. Here, liquid oil is being steam treated to remove solid debris. While reducing the amount of waste material, it can also generate income, which can offset the cost of disposal.
When you're dealing with mud or sand that's been cleaned up with the oil, what do you do with that?
Well, if you've got a lot of oily sand, one option is to actually mix that with an inorganic substance like quicklime, and that actually binds the material together and it stops the oil leaching out, which makes it easier to dispose of. And in some cases then you can use that in, say, land reclamation projects or as a road building material.
And when it's things like, I don't know, seaweed, for example, or, you know, any organic matter you might collect, then what?
Well, if you've got a lot of organic waste that's not too heavily oiled, one option is to try and compost that down to reduce the amount of organic waste. And what you would do is actually just put that into stacks to start the composting process and to start breaking down the material. And if you make sure that you have good air circulation, that speeds up the degradation process.
And some people might think, well, look, it's oil, you can just burn it. So is that a possible solution?
Yeah, I can understand why people would think that that is an attractive option. But in reality, once the oil is spent even a short period of time at sea, it's lost those light ends, the volatile components, and it's mixed with the seawater. So in reality, it's actually quite difficult to ignite it and burn it in its entirety.
Yeah.
And what you end up with is like a residue that's actually quite persistent. So burning oil is a bulk sort of strategy to try and remove the waste. It's not really a suitable method. But what you can do is actually take that oily material to specialist incineration facilities where it is burnt but in a controlled condition.
Specialist licensed facilities for high temperature incineration can take oily waste and burn it at temperatures in excess of 1,000 degrees centigrade to ensure complete and effective incineration. For bigger batches of oily waste, cement factories and industrial kilns are effective, but the waste shouldn't contain any large solids. If specialist incineration facilities are not available, then the last resort is often landfill.
Landfill sites have been a feature of waste disposal management for a very long time. In many countries, legislation has been brought in to control and restrict their use, and yet, for waste resulting from an oil spill, they are sometimes the only realistic option.
Typically, landfill sites are licensed under specific conditions, and that may put restrictions on the type of waste that can be received and indeed the volume of waste. And furthermore, sometimes the amount of oil also has to be below a set limit. And you find in a lot of countries you'll actually have landfill sites that are specially designated for accepting hazardous waste, which is what oily waste from an oil spill would be classified as. These specialist hazardous waste sites are actually few and far between, and quite often that means that they can be located quite a considerable distance from where the waste is actually being generated.
The majority of waste from an oil spill cleanup is likely to end up in either landfill sites or an incinerator, but we should still make sure we exhaust all other avenues before taking these options.
Quite simply, the key to it is thinking ahead, because if your contingency plan addresses how the waste is going to be stored, transported, and then possible options for treatment and disposal, then you're going to have a far more effective waste management system and hopefully reduce the amount of waste coming to a landfill site such as this.
Spill response needs to go beyond cleaning up the oil. Waste management requires strategic thinking and careful consideration. The storage, transportation, and disposal of waste might be more complex than you initially think. Therefore, a well-prepared plan goes a long way to overcoming this.
And for more details on any of the issues in this series, have a look at the ITOPF technical information papers at itopf.com/tips.